Yes, this recording is started. You can write your roll numbers in the chat box. Write your roll numbers in the chat box. Right, I hope the screen is visible. In last lecture, we have discussed this part two of unit three, which is introduction to ARM Cortex M3. In that, we have studied those things like fundamentals of ARM Cortex M3 processor, then registers, operational modes, then built-in ENVI-C, and the memory map, right? So this is what the functional block diagram of ARM Cortex M3 is, various functions associated with those blocks we have discussed in last lecture. After that, we have studied this register bank, right? So a total 16 registers are there, which is actually 32-bit in size. After that, some of the special function registers we have discussed, like XPSR, prime mask, fault mask, base parent control register. So actual control word format is to be discussed. We will discuss that shortly. So basically, those three register, prime mask, fault mask, and base prior interrupt masking register, they are used to disable the interrupts, right? And the status of program, like it's a kind of flag register you might have seen in the 8051. So program status register gives you different flags, right? And control register is used to switch between different access levels. So this significance we have seen. After that, we studied there are like two operational modes, which are thread mode and handler mode, right? Parallelly, it will have two different access levels, like privilege access and user access, right? So the difference between those levels and operating modes is, let us talk about the operational modes first. As I said, there are two operational modes. One is thread mode, and second one is handler mode. So when we are in a thread mode, the computer or laptop or let's say mobile, whatever is making use of that processor now, it will be doing its normal operation. Maybe it may be a sleep mode, right? So main program will be executed in a thread mode. Now, upon arrival of exception, the processor have to go in a handler mode, right? The reason is very simple. Thread mode मध्ये memory access हा limited असतो आणि handler mode मध्ये memory access complete memory access दिलेला असतो. And based on that access levels, we have two categories. One is user access and second one is privilege access. When we are handling the normal operation, it will be in a user access mode. But in order to access, in order to entertain different exceptions, it has to go in a privileged state. Means what? A complete memory access is to be given in order to handle the exceptions. So this is simple difference between those two operational modes and two user access levels to the memory. After that, we have studied this built-in nested vectored interrupt controller NVIC. Different functionalities associated with this NVIC are nested interrupt support, vectored interrupt support, dynamic priority change support, reduction of interrupt latency, and interrupt masking. We have discussed these things in detail in our last lecture. So without wasting much of time, we will move on to the memory map. And I told you these are the memory ranges assigned for different memories, different sort of purposes, right? So code memory, here we actually store the code. Here we store the instructions. And I told you this is from 00000000 onwards up to 1FFFFFFF. So total, if you count, it is going around 536 MB. But in a digital logic, we have to equate this to 512 MB. Right. So total of 512 MB space is allocated for code. After that, again, 512 MB is assigned for SRAM. SRAM is your static RAM. Then another 512 MB is assigned for peripherals. Then 1 GB is assigned for external RAM. External devices are of again 1 GB, and system level memory is around 512. Here you can say that it's a private peripheral including built-in NVIC, MPU and debug component. So these are private peripherals of ARM Cortex-M3 processor. So those private peripherals will be activated from this memory region, right? So this is all that we have studied in last lecture. Now let's move on to the today's topic of discussion. Let me close this part two. Today we will go with part three of this chapter, because I told you I have divided this in different parts. So this is part three of Cortex-M3, right? So you can note down the reference. The definitive guide is page number 17 to 24. Right, so this is the data sheet, page number 17 to 24. Contents I'm going to discuss here today are the bus interface. Bus means whatever internal connectivity is present with this Cortex-M3. Then MPU. MPU stands for memory protection unit. So we will discuss the use of MPU. Then we have instruction set. As already briefed you about instruction set and instruction set development. Now you know better what is thumb instruction, what is ARM instruction, what is thumb to instruction, etc. We will discuss that. We will see state transition, how we can switch between different instruction sets. Then we will see different interrupt and exceptions available with the Cortex-M3. In fact, the list I'm going to display so that you will come to know that how those 256 interrupts and exceptions works at a time with the vector addresses. After that, we will discuss the debug support, how it is important, and then we will see the summary of characteristics of Cortex-M3, right? So can someone give me feedback? Is it audible? It is visible? Yes, no?
Yes.
Audible and visible? Okay. So next point, as I told you, the bus interface, right? So there are several bus interface on the Cortex-M3 processor, and they allow the Cortex-M3 to carry the instructions, fetch the instructions, and they provide the data access at a time. So all those tasks can be possible at a time. So the main bus interface that we have here in a Cortex-M3 are three types are there, in fact. One is code memory bus, second is system bus, and third one is private peripheral bus, right? So three types of buses are there in a Cortex-M3. Let's see the significance of each and every bus one by one. This first one, code memory bus, right? So the code memory region access is carried out on a code memory bus, right? So I told you there are code region. So if you go back and if you look into the memory map, you will find the bottom most part region of that memory is code memory, right? So that code memory region is accessed through this code memory bus, which is physically consist of two buses. Now I am telling you the two types of code memory bus. This code memory bus will have two types. Physically, it will have two types. One is called as I code and second one is called as a decode bus. So in fact, I will add it here so that you will understand. So as I said, there are two types of code memory. One is I code bus and second one is decode bus. These are the two types of code memory bus. Right, so now what is the use of I code and what is the use of decode? I code bus carries instructions and decode bus carries data, right? So this is what as per its name implies, and it is the importance, it is the significance of code memory buses. Next we have is a system bus, right? So second type of bus is system bus. This system bus is used to access the memory and peripherals, right? And this provide access to the static RAM, static random access memory, that is SRAM. Also, it gives access to the peripherals, external RAM, external devices, and part of subsystem level memory regions, right? So most of the things will be carried on system bus. Code region is accessed by code memory. System bus will help you to get connected with SRAM, peripherals, external RAM, external devices, and the part of system level. Right? And last one is private peripheral. Private peripheral bus is only used to access the private peripherals. Now, what are the private peripherals allowed here in the Cortex-M3? You have MPU, Memory Protection Unit. You have NVIC, right? So all those private peripherals are accessed through this bus, private peripheral bus, which provide access to the part of system level memory dedicated to private peripherals, such as debugging component, MPU, and NVIC, right? I guess all the regions, how we are going to access those, all the regions you have understood. With the help of these bus interfaces, we can have access to all that 4GB memory space available with Cortex-M3. Right? So I guess it is clear. Code memory, accessed by code memory bus. Remaining almost all the regions will be accessed by system bus. And last part of that is private peripheral, in which private peripheral bus is used to access the only debug component, MPU, and NVIC. All the private peripherals access through private peripheral bus, right? So these are the three different major categories of buses available with Cortex-M3. Next we have is a MPU. And I told you what is MPU. It is a memory protection unit. This Cortex-M3 has an optional MPU. Optional MPU means what? Whenever it is required, you can make use of it. Optional means if you require, you can make use of it. So this unit allows access rules to be set up for privileged access and user program access. So when an this access rule is violated, a fault exception is generated. Exception is generated if the violation occurred for memory access, right? And the fault exception handler will be able to analyze the problem. So that fault exception will analyze that problem. What is the cause of that fault, right? So the operating system can set up its own MPU to protect the data from external access, to protect the data data used by OS kernel, and to protect it from other privileged processes, Right, so this is the use of MPU. It protects the data. Overall, it can help to make the embedded system more robust and reliable. What is the use of MPU? It can make the system, complete embedded system, more robust and reliable. Right, so one more thing is mentioned about this MPU is we can make the memory region read only. आता तुम्ही जर सपोज एखादा पेन ड्राईव्ह वगैरे असेल किंवा जुन्या टाईपचे मेमरी कार्ड्स बघितले असतील तर त्याला साईडला एक छोटासा स्विच यायचा, तो स्विच लॉक केला की त्याच्यावरची मेमरी रीड मेमरी व्हायची, रीड ओनली मेमरी व्हायची, म्हणजे यू कॅनॉट ऍड सॉंग्स ऑर फोटोज इमेजेस इन टू दॅट मेमरी कार्ड अंटील यू अनलॉक इट. राईट, सो रीड ओनली मेमरी केलं की त्याच्यावरती तुम्हाला रीड राईट ऑपरेशन करता, सॉरी रीड ऑपरेशन करता येत आहे पण राईट ऑपरेशन करता येणार नाही. सो एमपीयू सर्व्स हियर फॉर दिस पर्पज, इट इज सॉफ्टवेअर लॉक, यू कॅन कन्सिडर इट एज अ सॉफ्टवेअर लॉक, इट मेक द मेमरी रिजन रीड ओनली. अँड फायनल सिग्निफिकन्स, लास्ट सिग्निफिकन्स ऑफ एमपीयू इज इट्स ऑप्शनल अँड इट इज डिटरमाइंड ड्युरिंग द इम्प्लिमेंटेशन. मीन्स वॉट, इफ यू रिक्वायर इट, if it is needed during the implementation, then only MPU feature is enabled, otherwise it is kept disabled, it will be disabled. Right, so this is the significance of MPU. Then next is the instruction set. Right, I told you there are a couple of categories. One is ARM instruction, which is actually a 32-bit. Then we have this thumb instruction, which is a 16-bit instruction. And our Cortex-M3 support thumb-2 instructions, which is combination of 32-bit, that is ARM instruction, and thumb category, that is 16-bit instructions. Okay, right, so the instruction set, let us discuss how the instructions and state switching is possible with this Cortex-M3. Now basically I told you why this ARM 32-bit instructions are required and why those thumb state 16-bit instructions are required. The reason is most of the time you have to perform some critical task. So critical task can be performed with the minimum number of instruction in an ARM state, that is 32-bit instruction. 32-bit cha instructions vapurun tumhi complex task perform karu shakta. Pan asa kadhich hot nahi ki tumcha processor nehmi complex task kach karat asel. Most of the time processor will be in a sleep condition, it will be in a sleep mode. मग त्या केसमध्ये तुम्ही कोड डेन्सिटी व्यवस्थित ठेवण्यासाठी किंवा यू वॉन्ट टू रिड्यूस द कोड डेन्सिटी, इम्प्रूव्ह द कोड डेन्सिटी, देन इन दॅट केस यू हॅव टू स्विच टू थंब स्टेट. मग ज्यावेळी स्लीप मोड वगैरे ऑपरेशन्स असतील, इफ युअर प्रोसेसर इज डुईंग मेन प्रोग्राम, इन दॅट केस युअर थंब स्टेट हॅव टू बी ऍक्टिव्ह. अँड इफ यू वॉन्ट टू परफॉर्म सम complicated task, you have to switch to the ARM state, that is 32-bit instruction. Right, मग ज्यावेळी प्रोसेसर मेन प्रोग्राम एक्झिक्यूट करत असेल तर त्यावेळी तो थंब स्टेट मध्ये असणार आहे. इफ युअर प्रोसेसर वॉन्ट टू परफॉर्म सम क्रिटिकल टास्क, इट विल गो इन अ ARM 32-bit इन्स्ट्रक्शन सेट स्टेट. राईट, सो हाऊ इट विल गो टू दॅट स्टेट? For that, you have to execute the instruction such as BLX. BLX stands for branch with state change branch with state change. Means what? Current program execution will be stored and it will go for execution of this branch. After performing that critical task by using ARM 32-bit instructions, it will have to go back to the main program in which thumb state instructions are being executed. For that, we need to execute end instruction, that is BX or LR instruction. BX or LR instruction execute केल्यानंतर या ARM state मधून processor काय करेल switch होईल thumb state मधे. Right? So it is very simple mechanism. With BLX instruction, it will go to ARM state. With BX or LR instruction, it will come back to the main program in a thumb state. Right? So this Cortex M3 support basically thumb two instructions. This is one of the most important feature of Cortex M3, as I said. So this Cortex M3 processor, because it allows 32-bit instructions and 16-bit instructions to be used together for high code density and high efficiency purpose. So based on code density requirement and efficiency requirement, you can keep on switching between 16-bit and 32-bit instructions. In a previous ARM processor, I guess you have studied one ARM processor in embedded system. There, you can find the central processing unit that will have two operational states, a 32-bit ARM state and a 16-bit thumb state. Right? So this is the mechanism in previous version of Cortex M3. I'm not talking about this LPC 1678. Right? So this Cortex, this previous version of ARM processor will have such a mechanism to switch between 16-bit and 32-bit. Now let us understand. This ARM state and 16-bit thumb state, basically it is involved in ARM state, right? So it is involved in ARM processor. So the instructions are 32-bit and it can execute all the supported instructions with very high performance. In thumb state, the instructions are 16-bit. So there is much higher instruction code density, as I said. Right, so if you want to high code density, you have to switch to the thumb state. But the thumb state does not have all the functionalities of ARM instructions. Right, and if I want to execute the complex task, you have to switch to ARM instructions. And it requires more instructions to complete a certain type of operation. Right. So hence I can say here, to get the best of both, you have to keep switching between ARM and thumb. However, this mixed code arrangement does not always work well, because every time you have to execute those instructions, BLX and BXLR. This is what the mechanism of earlier ARM processor is. But here in Cortex M3, you don't have to do this. It happens automatically. Let me tell you how. With introduction to thumb 2 instruction. Now see here, Cortex M3, I told you it supports thumb 2 instructions, right? So with the introduction of this thumb 2 instruction set, it is now possible to handle all the processing requirement in one operation. There is no need to switch between those two, means thumb state and ARM state. You don't have to switch between those two states, right? So you don't have to switch between those two states. It happens automatically. So in fact, Cortex M3 does not support ARM code. In fact, it is going to be switched between those two states. Even if the interrupts are now handled with thumb state, right? So there is no need to switch between states of Cortex M3 that has more number of advantage over traditional ARM processor. right? So number of instruction, use of number of instruction is reduced. Right, so I hope you understood. Whatever you are able to see on the screen, it is supported by previous version of ARM. Where you want to switch, you have to use this instruction BLX. If you want to switch back, you have to execute these instructions like BX and LR. And this would create unnecessarily overhead because it consumes the time. If you say BLX, it requires time to store the content of program counter. It load the new address. Again, it at the end, again, it will take some overhead, means the time to get back to the main program. So it creates unnecessarily the overhead. Now let us talk about Cortex-M3. I told you Cortex-M3 do not require this manual switching. It happens automatically. And advantage of that is no state switching overhead, saving both execution time and instruction space. This is first advantage of Cortex-M3. Second advantage of Cortex-M3 is no need to separate ARM code and thumb code source files, making software development and maintenance easier. Right, so you don't have to write separate instructions of thumb and separate instructions of ARM and then switching in between. You can write ARM instructions and thumb instruction in a common file. You can switch in between. And last one is, it's easier to get the best efficiency. These are some of the advantages. Some of the benefits are quoted about the Cortex-M3. Right, I guess it is clear. Is it understood? किती जण जागे आहेत बघूयात. अनम्यूट युअर सेल्फ. Okay, you can mute now. Why the strength is so less today? Okay, we will proceed further. Right, so I discussed about this instruction set. Next and a very important part of this Cortex-M3 is exception types. So on the left hand side, can you see the exception number? So exception number would start from 0 and it ends at 255. Total exceptions, how many interrupts are there? Around, not around, exactly they are 256. Right? So those main number of instructions, interrupts are there with Cortex M3. Right? So 256 interrupts are there. Let us see one by one. And the type of exception is also important. So first exception is NA. It is reserved. So you can assign afterwards. So no exception running at this moment. Right? So this is what unallocated exception you can say. Then after that, we have a reset vector. Right. So the priority is also mentioned here. -3 means highest priority. +3 means lowest priority. Here, the default priority is -3. And that simply means it is highest priority. And the use is reset. So when you press the reset button, highest priority interrupt is generated. Highest priority interrupt is generated. And that interrupt will be executed first. तुम्ही कितीही कॉम्प्लिकेटेड टास्क किंवा अर्जंट इम्पॉर्टंट टास्क करत असाल तुम्ही करू शकता. समटाइम्स यू हॅव हार्ड रिसेट बटन ऑन मोबाईल्स. बघा तुमच्या मोबाईलला जर एक छोट हार्ड बटन, त्या बटनला जर तुम्ही प्रेस केला किंवा तुम्ही कंट्रोलर वगैरे त्याचं रिसेट बघितलं, त्याचं रिसेट बटन जे आपण प्रेस करतो इरिस्पेक्टिव्ह ऑफ करंट एक्झिक्युशन, इरिस्पेक्टिव्ह ऑफ प्रोग्राम दॅट बीइंग एक्झिक्युटेड, ऑल द प्रोग्राम्स विल स्टॉप वर्किंग. ऑल द प्रोग्राम एक्झिक्युशन इज स्टॉप अँड विथ हायेस्ट प्रायोरिटी रिसेट विल ऑकर. रिसेट मीन्स loading content PC, loading PC the content 000, right? So it will start all the way from the location. So this is one of the exception type. Then we have NI. NI stands for external non-maskable input, right? So this is another then we have hard fault. Right. So all fault conditions, if the corresponding fault handler is not enabled, this is at -1 priority. Then we have memory management fault. Right. It is programmable. Means what? Programmable means what? You can set its priority. You can set it high, you can set it to a program that you are. So this fourth, fifth exception type, the memory management fault is a programmable. You can decide the priority, and based on the priority, you can choose at what time this exception gets handled. Right. So memory management fault, I told you, MPU detects the memory violations or access to legal locations. If it is not happening, then this memory management fault will occur and you can decide when to execute. Then we have bus fault. Bus fault means the data or the instruction, everything is going to be carried on the bus. So the bus fault will be occurred. It is a kind of bus error, or in say pre-page abort or data abort, like it's a kind of data loss. If it is occurred, this fault is generated and you can set the priority based on your program. Means what? You can set the priority to high or you may set it to low depending upon your need. After that, next type of exception is usage fault. Right? So usage fault, it is a program error. So when it is occurred, if it is occurred, you can decide the priority level, whether you want to set it to high or you want to keep it to low. After that, 7 to 10, they are reserved. And 4 exceptions are reserved. So you can create your own exceptions and you can put it into those empty locations, unused locations. Right? we have SV call. Right? SV call means supervisory call. If supervisory call is arrived, exception is occurred, you can set the level, priority level to high or low depending upon the program. It is programmable. Then we have debug monitor. Again, it is programmable. So debug monitor, when it is when this actually arises, we have some breakpoints, watch points, and external debug request reserved, right? So in Keel, Microvision, you might have seen those breakpoints and watch points, right? So for a particular segment of code, how that code behaves can be observed. So if it is not behaving as per expectation, you can generate this type of exception, like debug monitor. And you can set priority level based on your requirement. Okay. Dash partitions report. Okay. I wish it nice. Could you mind? Right. So this debug, when exception is heard, you can decide the number is reserved in choice. You can design it and you can make use of this reserved exception. Pendable request for system service. It is another kind of programmable exception. System stick, right? So it corresponds to timer overflow. When timer overflow, you can observe this exception is occurred. And RQ, we have almost and around 240 external interrupt sources. And just you can keep on checking the status. Button connector is either threshold doom device. For example, heart rate monitor. Heart rate monitor is a sensor, so to patient audio testing. Since the output jahete cortex 3 processor and it our titumi decide current heart bit rate. If it is above 70 bits per second, then no. And if it is below 70, then give buzzer. Minus kind of make exception and 70 cha khali ala tar to exception. And you can treat this as an exception. But this 70 cha khali ala tar kai auto injection, kiwa ekad IV vagere te alat suru karta hai te ka automatic. You can have automation on this. So around 240 such exceptions you can have at a time with a call. Those charges such external exceptions to me give shakani at time run go. Right? Me ek example sangi the heart rate monitor karne ek ada exception to me bahu shakta. But similar to that, you can have 240 exceptions at a time. Simultaneously, you can execute those 240 exceptions. Address 17 to 255. You have 60 to 255. You have all those external interrupts 0 to 239. And importantly, you set priority level of those external interrupts based on your choice to the program and set their priority. Right, so these are exceptions and interrupts, different exceptions and interrupts we have in M3. This is So I told you with the debug support we can generate the errors. This is basically a thing, which is API. So what is API? Program interface. Sorry, ID, integrated development environment. And debugging support is one of the component of IDE, integrated development environment. That may have editor, assembler, linker, right? Debugger, uploader, loader. Lot of things are there, a lot of functionalities associated with those function blocks. Now we are talking about debugger. I mean, what? Just by observing the output of the compiling, just observing that system, you can get the errors, you can check whether the system is perfectly working or not, and can have the modifications in the old code. Now, how this debugger port works actually is summarized here. Right, so the hardware of Quantum 3 processor is based on core slate. What core slate? Let me tell you. It's a feature such as program execution, controls, including handling and stepping, instruction waveform and data watch point, registers and memory. These are the things are included in the feature. Right, so these main tasks are to be performed by debug support. Now, the CPU core itself does not have a joint detection group. That is what JTAG group, right? So this debug interface module decoupled from the core, and bus interface called as DAP. Means what? A debug access port is provided at the core level. Right? So instead of JTAG, DAP is provided. Instead of JTAG, DAP is provided for connect. Then this debug port is provided. So through this bus interface, external debuggers can access control to the register, and they can control the debug hardware as well as memory, even when the processor is running. So the control of this bus interface is carried out by DP, as I said. DP means debug port device. This DP currently available is available in the serial wire protocol. And that serial wire protocol means JTAG debug port. JTAG debug port, right? So in short, we can call it as serial wire JTAG debug support, debug port, SWJ-DP, right? So this is the short form of that. Then within the Cortex M3 processor, a number of events can be used to trigger the debug action, debug event, and it can create a breakpoint or watch point. Right, so this breakpoint and watch point are possible with the debug support. So the data watch point function is provided by data watch point and trace. That is what called as a DWT. DWT means data watch point and trace. And this data trace information can be generated. Now, when this data trace is used, and traced data can be output via DPIU. What is this DPIU? DPIU means Trace Port Interface Unit, right? So these are the, you can say, the specialities of debugging support. And I told you flash patch and breakpoint. Breakpoint and watch point, I told. This breakpoint means you can break the segment code and you can observe the behavior of that particular code, right? So a small unit you can break and you can observe the behavior. This is what the support provided in Cortex M3 in short, right? Next is characteristic summary. Characteristic summary, now here, if I want to talk about this characteristic summary, I can list high performance, advanced interrupt handling feature, low power consumption, system feature, and debug support. These are the highlighting features of Cortex M3. Now let us understand one by one. High performance means what? Many of the instructions, including multiply or a single cycle, they are just Cortex M3 processor outperform most of the support this kind of feature. Why high performance? Another reason is it's a separate data in instruction versus simultaneous instruction. बघा जसं मी डी कोड आणि ए कोड सांगितलं होता राईट सेपरेट डेटा इन्स्ट्रक्शन बस दॅट विल अलाउ सायमल्टेनियस डेटा अँड इन्स्ट्रक्शन देन कम टू इन्स्ट्रक्शन सेट मेक स्टेट स्विचिंग ओव्हरहेड हिस्ट्री मीन्स व्हॉट द कम टू इन्स्ट्रक्शन सेट मेक्स द स्टेट स्विचिंग विदाउट ओव्हरहेड देन The thumb two instructions instruction set provide extra flexibility in programming. That is why we can call them as a high performance. And last reason why we are calling it as a high performance is Cortex M3 design allows microcontroller products to operate in a high clock frequency over 100 megahertz. I guess you have studied 8-7 with 16 or 12 megahertz frequency. Right, so here this operates with 100 megahertz frequency. So this is some of the reasons of high performance. Why we call it a performance? Then we have advanced interrupt handling capability. Now I told you this reason of being advanced interrupt handling feature is. This is having NVIC support. NVIC means nested vectored interrupt controller, and it supports 240 external interrupt. Right? Just now I told you 240 external interrupt inputs are there, and all of them are vectored interrupt features. All of them are vectored means what? They have their own vector addresses defined. Right, so this vector interrupt feature considerably reduces the interrupt latency, and because there is no need to use the software to determine which interrupt request is to handle, right? So it happens automatically, and vector address is being loaded into a program counter. After that, IR interrupt service subroutine is executed. Again, it goes back to the processor. Hello. Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
Screen sharing. Hello. Screen sharing. Keyboard here. Okay. So another feature of Cortex M3 is advanced interrupt handling. I told you 140 interrupts are supported in this Cortex M3. The Cortex M3 processor automatically push all those R0 to R3, R12 and link register and C in a stack memory upon arrival on the external. So switching of the register contents on stack memory happens when the external interrupt is arrived. Then we have low power consumption. Why we say low power consumption? Let me tell you. The Cortex M3 processor is suitable for low design because it is having power saving modes such as sleep mode and sleep deep mode. Now, here I have coded two types of sleep mode supported in Cortex M3. two types of cortex sleeping modes in cortex. Number one, sleeping mode, and second one is sleep mode. Right? I'll tell you the significance later on about this sleeping modes. For a while, cortex M3 processor can enter in a sleep mode with WFE instruction. Only two instructions can enter in sleep mode. Right, so Cortex M3 can spend much of time in a sleep mode, and it's said it's having a low power consumption. And system feature, different system features, like it's having big band operation. Byte in variant, big Indian mode is supported here, right? Having advanced finding feature includes very exception types and for status resistance, making it easier to do problems. And we have a stack pointer. That's why we call it as a differently featured, or you can say system features are very shadowed stack pointer means what? There are two stack pointers. Only one is used at a time, right? So stack memory of kernel and the user process can be isolated. And the operating system जो stack pointer चा use होतो, and user कडून जो stack pointer चा use होतो, दोन stack pointers असल्यामुळे ते use separate ठेवता येतात, right? So with the shadow stack pointer, stack memory of kernel, user process can be isolated. Right, so this is about a system feature. Next one is debug support, and I told you debug support, it's having a support to JTAG interface or serial wire debug support. Right, serial wire debug support and JTAG interface is allowed here. Based on core site debugging solution, status or memory content can be accessed even when the core is running. The core is running means the crystal oscillator is running, right? And one more thing is built-in support for 6 breakpoints and 4 watch points. This will be a HQ. Debug support मध्ये किती breakpoints असतात आणि किती watch points असतात. Debug support मध्ये 6 breakpoints असतात, 6 breakpoints दिलेले आहेत आणि 4 watch points दिलेले आहेत. म्हणजे तुम्ही 6 वेळा segment break करून त्यांना ठिकाणी program break करून ते error किंवा bugs identify करू शकता. 6 breakpoints and 4 watch points. So yes, the presentation is over. Yeah, if you have any doubt you can ask, otherwise it's 258. If you have mentioned your roll number in chat box, if you don't have any doubt, you are allowed to drop the call. If you want, you can leave the meeting now.